Hey folks, Sirdar here, and in this episode of Dev with Sirdar, we're going to look at parallelism and concurrency in Python. In plainer English, we're going to look at all the ways you can do more than one thing at once, or switch between many things efficiently. When you want to do more than one thing at once in computing, there's two basic paradigms to keep in mind: parallelism and concurrency. Parallelism is about doing multiple tasks side by side. It's like having multiple checkout lanes in a grocery store. Each checkout lane handles different customers and runs independently of the others. In Python, we have multiprocessing for parallelism. Each task runs in a separate instance of the Python executable. Concurrency also involves doing multiple tasks, but by interleaving them. Let's say you have five people you need to call and get a reply from. So you make a phone call, leave a message, make another phone call, leave another message, and so on and so forth. And then you handle each reply as it comes in. Since we're going to be spending most of our time waiting for people to get back to us, we can fire off the calls first and then efficiently use the time waiting for replies to get other work done. So in Python, this would be done by way of threading or async. So let's take a look at some code examples of all these methods in action. Now, a very common example of a task that you could perform concurrently or in parallel is getting responses from a bunch of different websites. So I have here four examples of how to do this. And the first is the least efficient way. We have a list of sites that we want to contact, and we iterate over them one at a time and use urllib's request to fetch the data. Now this runs, the problem is that we have to wait for each site to respond before moving on to the next one. And we spend most of our time waiting. So why not fire off all the requests at once and wait for them to come in all at once? Well, that's exactly what we do in the second example, which uses threading. The concurrent.futures module in Python gives us a mechanism called a thread pool executor. It's a way to create a pool of threads into which we can submit tasks, and those tasks will then be completed for us automatically in the background. Now, there's two ways we can use threads. The first is that we submit all the jobs that we want to run as threads, we wait for all of them to finish, and then we look at the results once they're done. And the thread pool's map function lets us do this. It takes the function we want to run, which is fetch, and it runs parallel instances of it on each element in our list of sites. So when all of these threads are finished, we get the results back. Now, one possible downside to this approach is that we have to wait for everything to finish before we can move on to the next step. This blocks everything else from executing. Now, sometimes that's what we want because we can't really do anything else without the results in, but sometimes we want to evaluate results as they come in. And that's where this next way of using a thread pool comes in, the submit function. It takes a function and its arguments, starts running it, and then immediately gives back a new object called a future, which represents the state of the job's execution. And this line here, this creates a list that contains all the futures for all the jobs that we've submitted. So we run this, and then we can move on from it and do whatever other work we want to in the meantime while these jobs finish up in the background. And then, when we want to look at the results, we can use the asCompleted function from concurrent.futures, and this goes through a list of the futures that we've supplied and returns results from them one at a time as they come in. Now, if you'll run this code, you can see what I mean. In this first part here, the fetching of the data from each site all happens in a single batch. Each site is fetched concurrently, though, each on top of the other. And then we see the results, again, all in a single batch. But in the second approach, we get the results from each fetch as it comes in, and the fetches are all being performed on top of each other as well. So this way, you have two different methods for handling concurrent behavior. You can scatter and gather the results, as they say, or you can evaluate each result in turn. Now let's take a look at the same code using multiprocessing. Instead of spinning up threads managed cooperatively by the Python runtime, multiprocessing spins up separate copies of the Python interpreter, each running on a separate core, running side by side independent of each other. The downside is that you have to launch a whole copy of Python for each job. It's very top heavy. But what's nice with concurrent.futures is that we can use almost exactly identical code for multiprocessing as we did with threading. Instead of a thread pool executor, we have a process pool executor. And we have map and submit, which behave in exactly the same way. Map lets us scatter and gather, and submit lets us evaluate results as they come in. So why multiprocessing instead of threading. Well, I mentioned before, in Python, threads are cooperative. They yield to each other as needed. And that's good for jobs that mostly involve waiting, like reading from the network. But anything CPU intensive, like performing some processing on each of these jobs, would not be effective in threads. With multiprocessing, you can run a CPU-intensive workload in multiple instances, all side by side, each on a different physical core of your machine. So for this example, I've simulated a CPU-intensive workload by inserting a sleep statement in the fetch command. So if we run this code, you'll see that all the sleep statements are running side by side on top of each other. So instead of sleeping for 5 seconds for each of these jobs, we end up sleeping for 1 second in aggregate, and everything else runs as we'd expect. Now, I should note that Python's limitations on threading may be going away in future versions of the language. I made another video about this. I've linked it in the description, and it talks in detail about this very exciting work. But it will be a long time before that becomes useful to everyone, and when that happens, I will be sure to come back and revisit the subject. But for now, though, use threads for things that are not about waiting on CPU, but waiting on I/O, like network data or user input, and use multiprocessing for things that are CPU intensive. The last paradigm that I want to show off is async. Async is like threading in that it's for jobs that yield to each other cooperatively. They aren't CPU bound. They mostly involve waiting on other things. The downside with async is that you have to structure your code using async syntax, and you have to use async designed libraries to get the best results. But async tasks are much more lightweight than threads or processes. It's not uncommon to set up and switch between thousands of tasks with very little overhead. But for this example, we'll just use these 5. The first thing you'll notice is that each of these functions has the keyword async to indicate that it runs as part of a chain of async functions. We also aren't going to be using urllib. Instead, we have to use a third-party library for async web requests called AIO-HTTP. And the way we perform our requests is a lot like what we did for our other examples. When we wanted to evaluate results, we create tasks. And with each task, we get back a future object representing the state of that task. And again, we can go through these futures in one of two ways. One, we can wait for all the results to complete. And to do that automatically, we can use a unit of organization for async tasks called a task group. This with block sets up a task group in which we set up each of the tasks, and then when we exit the block, it will ensure that before we exit the block, all the tasks are finished. So that's a way to do the scatter and gather operation that we talked about. Option 2, we can evaluate each task as it's finished. And for that, we don't need a task group. We can just create tasks and work with the futures. And to do that, we use the async.io.asCompleted function. Sounds familiar? And we use that to yield up each task as it finishes. So if we run this code, you can see how the scatter and gather and the task at a time operations both work. So to sum up, when you want to do more than one thing at a time in Python, you have your choice of threads, async I/O, or multiprocessing. Threads are for jobs that mostly involve waiting on something else, like the network. Same with async, but you can spin up orders of magnitude more async jobs than threads at the cost of using async syntax and libraries. Multiprocessing is for anything with some degree of CPU activity, but with the overhead of multiple instances of the Python interpreter. And with all of these, you have the option of evaluating all results once they've finished, or one at a time as they come in, depending on your needs. And that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.